guys, welcome. We have like a huge live audience, I guess you can say, because we are here celebrating some real big things. Woo! Yay! Yay! Yes. I'm sorry, I didn't see Kia come. Hi, Kia. All right, Miss Miller.
What's up?
The titles have changed.
Yeah.
Yes. Real quick, to give you guys a brief introduction to what we're about to get ready to do. We're going to have a segment of this conversation. We are trusting that this space is a very honest and open and receptive space. The both of us will be sharing things and mostly hearing from her and getting her new perspective on new ideas. And so this is going to be a part of my segment of Pep Talk. If anyone who does not know, I'm the author of Pep Talk, No BS Conversation about Boundaries, Blessings, and Becoming. And so we are going to girl power, come together, and make some magic happen, right? The addition to that is my sister, my sister in Christ is also the producer of my new show. And so I just want to make sure I highlight everything about this woman and everything that she's doing with the salon, with her book, with her PR, and just really stepping out and saying it's time to put the spotlight on her. I think you're ready.
I'm ready.
You ready?
Today's October 8th. 8th is the number of new beginnings.
Yes, it is. Here we go.
It's 8 chapters in new growth.
Hey! This is all intentional. I'm not.
Yes. I don't play willy-nilly. I know what I'm doing.
I love it. Well, let's get right to it.
Yeah.
So first of all, introduce yourself.
Well, I am Sade Miller. I am the owner of Sade Styles Beauty Pine Braid Lounge right here where you guys are sitting. I am also an entertainment publicist. I represent artists like Hitmaker at the time, but I have represented Latasha Scott from Escape, J Nova, Yella Beezy, etc.
Okay.
I am also an author now, and I am on to this new journey, and this is where I'm at right now.
I love it.
So that's the Sade.
I love it. I was skimming through the book really quickly to find some inspiration because you never want to go into a situation already having things pre-planned out. You kind of want to be in the moment, right? And one of the things that stood out to me was the word perspective. Yeah. And I want to know, how has your perspective changed since becoming an author?
Since becoming an author, it's more of like, I've always valued being a woman of my word, but now it's like on paper. And it's here, and now everyone else has the proof of that. So I you know, I really have to show up and, you know, prove who that Sade is.
Right.
And although that is me deep down, it's like now I really have to exude and illuminate that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my new perspective.
So it's a new becoming for you.
For sure.
What does that feel like?
It feels great. Yeah. I feel alive. I feel flowy. I'm in representative of what I'm wearing.
Yes.
The color. I'm intentional. So, you know, even the colors in the salon, like, I love the spa. I used to go to the spa every top of the month. So the colors, the jade colors, that's all about the spa, the browns. I'm intentional. So this was never by mistake.
And the book is the exact same thing, A Journey Towards Wellness and Self-Worth. Everybody give her a round of applause. So, as a fellow author, I completely understand how challenging and scary it can feel to put your story out there.
For sure.
Because once you put your story out there, you can't take that back. You know what I'm saying? Because you kind of open everybody else up into the realm. And what most people do not understand is when you become an author and you want to create something that shares your testimony to prove to other people how they can transform their life and gain new perspective, we, in a sense, lose a part of ourselves because those are things that's very, very near and dear to us.
Yeah.
But at the same time, we release it and then we give it to y'all.
Right.
Right? So how do you feel to now give up the trauma?
I feel lighter, but I did have an outer body experience.
Tell us about that.
It was like, I mean, I told my dude, like, delete it all. I'm good. Like, it's cool. You know, even though I invested in myself, I spent the time to do it. Once I pressed submit, it was like, I was like, all right, talk about it, be about it. Mm-hmm. And I had an out-of-body experience, and I was like, show up in this way, because now it's like
the old hat died.
And no, it really died. It, you know, you're right. It died, and it was like, all right, now show up for real.
Right.
You know, I have the shop. I've had the clients. I've done the work behind the scenes, and that's always been my game. But now it's like pushing me. It's like, okay, now it's your turn for real. Mm-hmm. Outside of just, you know, your turn as far as the opportunities, it was like, okay, it's your turn to really, like, be in the forefront and show your face more, talk more, do this and do this. Yes. You know, it was like, all right, it's time to show up for real.
And you chose a book.
Yeah.
Why? What was the inspiration behind that?
I've had so many inspirations. My best friend, who, her mother is she really was an inspiration, because chapter 2 is called Freedom from Bondage.
Right.
And LaRonda Bradley, by the way, she was the first person I really seen have a book physically. Her book was called Freedom from Bondage. And she played an intricate part in my Stop the Silence experience. And so I chose that to be, you know, an inspiration for me when it came to, like, really writing the book and seeing it. Because you go off of model behavior, and if you never really seen it, you're not going to really do it.
Right.
So the fact that I seen it, like, physically, and held her book, and then I was like, okay, it's possible for me. Then my homegirl, Destiny, Foxy, Foxy D, but this is 4G, this is her brand. She wrote a book called Karma, and I was like, oh, bitch, like, okay, I can really write a book.
Right, then
you wrote a book, and so I was like, all right, like, for real, I got to get to it.
Right.
And so that was, like, the inspiration when it came to model behavior. Then I've had plenty of inspirations when it came to my mom, my sisters, you know, you, my friends, my dude, like, everybody who I've included in acknowledgements plus more have always been, like, a piece of me. And so that was, like, all right, all of you guys became something inspiration for me to, like, pull from, you know, based off of the small things that I learned from you. So it all kind of worked together, and that was, like, the thing to where it's like, okay. And timing is everything, because I've always wrote. I've had journals. Every place I've had plethoras of journals.
This is true.
Very true.
I've had
so many journals, and when I went through my spiritual advisory therapy, he was like, tear pieces up from those pages of those journals that you really feel like you can hold on to, and then throw away the rest. Because you have to begin to release whatever that is. And so that was, like, the beginning of my journey of, like, writing the book, not really even knowing. Chapter 1, Stop the Silence, is really my freshman year college essay. And I didn't really realize it until it was out. So.
Wow.
Manifestation
already in progress. Like, you know, I have been knowing Sade since she was 16.
Westchester
High, 08 for me. Okay. But, you know, and just when I first met her, I was a dance block captain, and I saw her just really going hard dancing. Like, she was just committed, you know. She was like, I'm just going to be a part. I'm a commit. And it was just something in that personality where, for me, just kind of, I get the opportunity to kind of sit up and look at everybody else, right, and see who do I want on the team, and who do I want to be a part of this sisterhood, brotherhood, like, what do we want for the vision? And from the very moment that we met, I think it was, like, two nights later, I hit her up, like, hey, you're going to come to dance class with me in Hollywood. And from that very moment, this sisterhood has just completely grown, and I've seen her grow and mature. And this is probably one of the relationships when it comes to sisterhood where we have been completely authentic from the beginning.
Right.
You know how some people just want to fit in just to fit in? We didn't have to fit in because it just fit. You know what I'm saying? And with new growth, and right now, if you can go back to that little girl who was making big decisions, and you know what I'm talking about. Making big decisions, what would you say to her right now?
I would say I'm proud of you, because that little girl is the 13-year-old girl that was on the couch and that told herself to get your voice afterwards.
Are you comfortable talking about what that escape was?
I don't know.
Okay. So what was that escape?
The escape was the molestation of my father and, you know, just being in that position to where fight or flight. Mm-hmm. And I chose to fly. And I got myself up, went out that phone, got to some type of strategy.
At 13.
At 13. Yeah, my mom. I'm the fuck. Who is?
Right. Amen.
You so speak
you learned boundaries. Exactly. Very young. What does boundaries mean to you?
Boundaries mean definitely using your voice and definitely being in a position to, if you're not feeling comfortable, whatever that looks like, to just communicate. Like, it's that simple.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, of course you want to be respectful. You don't ever want to be offensive and rub people the wrong way.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's a situation, if it's just even a friendship, relationship, whatever, just say, hey, babe, hey, homegirl, hey, homeboy, hey, bro, hey, right. Sis, you know, I wasn't feeling that.
Mm-hmm.
I just have to do that recently. Like, you know, it's nothing. I love you, though.
Right. Because it's always evolving, right? Once we get to one level in our lives, there's always another level. We're constantly climbing.
Mm-hmm. Accountability.
Right. And it seems like you have been a savior for a lot of people mm-hmm. for a long time.
That's not crazy.
It is really crazy. Even in your lines of work before mm-hmm. even getting up to media and broadcasting
mm-hmm.
And being behind the scenes.
Right.
What is that like to feel like, even though you know you're making the right decision when it comes to accountability and boundaries, and you know you are being a voice that echoes something of just challenges,
mm-hmm.
Does that tie into the personality of when I met you prior, like of you, the people pleasing and wanting to do things for other people, like, and what is that like?
I feel like it's a catch 22 because a part of it was the people pleasing, the trying to figure out identity, you know, outside of my trauma. It was like, okay, so what's next? What does that look like outside of trying to like make sure that I feed myself in education and perfectionism and whatever that looks like to where I can like cope in that instead of my trauma. So I tried to figure out a way that it can kind of make sense for both. Obviously, being in the background as far as a publicist, it was, you know, lucrative. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know, there's money in that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, it made sense for me. And it's funny you say Echo, buzzword. Like, that was the first woman, Echo Haddocks, Echo and Sales, shout out.
Mm-hmm.
She gave me a chance just
mm-hmm.
off of Instagram. And we just connected off of our signs. I'm Aquarius, she's Aquarius. And we were just vibing off that. I was like, hey, what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
And she took me under her wings. And she was, like, the first person in the industry to kind of, like, put me in this position to, like, be a real bitch. Like,
mm-hmm.
and say, like, hey, like, what does transparency look like in this field?
Right.
What does respect and legacy look like in this field?
Right.
And so that taught me a lot. And I just held that on to me outside of, like, being someone who was timid and not using my voice and being behind the scenes. I started to build my creativity. And now being at the Purple Agency, being under Felicia Fant, who's a force in the
yes.
industry. She's a force, like, force, you know, she come hard. And being under her has, like, slowly taught me. We've had conversations where she's like, yo, Sade, think before you speak sometimes. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know, and not in a
no,
sense
tough
of,
love.
You know,
yeah.
like, tough
mm-hmm.
love in a sense of, like, sometimes in this industry, you have to be able to pull it together before you take anything personal because
yeah.
they just want the results.
Right, yeah.
And you feeling it as a person that who's an empath.
Right.
And I'm like, well, dang, what do you want?
Right.
Like, you know, I'm trying to figure out the relationship part. She's like, no, it's different here.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like I've been able to be in the position to learn a lot to where now I'm in a position to where it's like, yo, it's me.
Right.
It's new growth.
Yeah.
And, you know, speaking of Felicia, like, in the book, it's I proved that, you know, she's a force, but she's also been the person who invested in my spiritual
mm.
advisory
really?
Therapy. Yeah. Mm. To where align yourself with people that see you, because you have a voice. And because people, when the people who see me, that gives me quote unquote permission to have a voice. You know.
So you found your voice.
I found my voice, and I'm still learning.
I know a little bit about the very first time that you found your strength in your voice, in your adulthood. When did that recalibrate? Like, when did it feel like I've been here before?
When did it feel like I've been here before, where I had to find my voice again?
Yes, and let me make sure I explain. We're not new to this. We're true to this.
Yeah. Okay. This is our normal conversations. These are our like normal. Almost every day.
Right.
Driving to work.
Yeah, like
every Tuesday, it was like, hey,
tap in Tuesday.
Tap in Tuesday.
So that space of recalibration, because we haven't, this is not our first rodeo. Mm-hmm. There's been times I know in my life where I go through a situation, I'm like, why does this feel familiar? Like, why do I feel strong? Why do I feel like I can overcome this? Where I know somebody else will be in this position and they can possibly crumble. Mm-hmm. When did that recalibrate for you? Like, was there a moment in your adulthood? Because it's different from being a child.
Yeah.
And you are stepping on eggshells. But in your personal life, your personal relationships, not just the work, but like the personal voice, when did that recalibrate and say, you got this feeling of, I think I know what I'm doing?
And so that's why that is the name of the chapter. and not recognizing the value that I hold, you know, and knowing that obviously these dudes or these friendships are coming around me because obviously I hold something, but I also felt like, damn, I need to validate. They need to validate whatever I need. Mm-hmm. But it was like, I came to a conclusion, I was like, yo, like, I can validate myself. Right. It's not about what or who around me validates me. It's, Sade, tap into what your mom taught you to date yourself. Mm-hmm. Go to the movies. Go to have a dinner. Have a happy hour. All those things by yourself. And those are things that I've already known and I've already done before, but sometimes, you know, sometimes
the perspective changes.
It changes. Yeah. Like, life be lifing.
I did it like this, but let me do it like this.
Yeah, and right. You know, you're going to get right, lost in the sauce. And, and like I said, life be lifing. And so I remember having a conversation with myself and I was like, yo, like, I'm not about to just do, I'm doing too much.
Right.
To be.
Giving up too much of myself.
I've given it too much to myself. Everybody. I'm exhausted. It's too many energies. I'm doing too much. Mm-hmm. And so I just was like, Sade, it's about you. Whatever you want to do. If you want to date him, cool. But whatever, on your terms. Mm-hmm. And so that's where I was. I was like, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever. I was at peace with that. Then my homegirl's like, hey, Memorial weekend, let's go to Vegas. And I was like, you know, I don't know. They was flying and everything. I was like, I don't know if I want to go. And they was like, come on, let's go. They flew. I was like, all right, I'll drive up the next weekend, the next day, morning. Mm-hmm. And so I just drove up by myself, bumping my music. I was feeling good. I remember the feeling that I was in. I was at peace. I was free.
That's a nice call.
I was in full feminine energy. You know, I was, that's where I was. I was like, we don't need no dudes to pay for a table, no bottle, no nothing. We got it.
Right.
Like, and I'm coming here to just enjoy my time with my homegirls and to just be in that. And whatever happens. But it's kind of like when you say that, it's like I kind of unlocked something with God. And it was like, he was like, okay, thank you, Sade, because you said what I needed you to say and come to the realization where I needed you to come. We was in the elevator. Okay. Miss Stay talking about a whole lot of estrogen. Feminine energy.
Right.
But I say that to, it's funny, but it's not funny because it's a line because I specifically said I'm tapping into my feminine energy. Yes, right. And then for him to say it's a whole lot of estrogen, whoa.
Right. That instant connection.
It's small things, but the small things is big things.
I have an acronym, it's called KISS. It stands for keep it simple, sweet. So anything simple is grand. When you complicate and you overcomplicate life, it makes it more challenging and difficult. But in your life, you want to try to do anything to systematically keep it simple.
Yes.
Right. And so he made you feel safe on instant, is what you're saying?
Instant. I felt like I know this man. I had to ask my home.
First of all, y'all look alike, so. Two or more gathered together, okay, is blessed. Yeah. amen to that.
Yeah.
So I can't wait to see what the future of that looks like. But we're gonna slow you down. We're not trying to look at him praying.
Proactive. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to make sure, like, yo, don't get it twisted.
Right.
That one right there got me.
That was your father, but that was her partner.
Right, and that's why because I remember we had a conversation of, you know, her being in a position where she felt how she felt, and I was like, no, that's not what it is. You know, clearly you and him created me, so it is what it is. Right. Y'all was a vessel to create me,
right.
And I've been watching so many interviews where it explains that parents are just a vessel. You do what you do, you do what you can,
right.
But that's just what it is. You're a vessel to create somebody right. in your life,
right.
And they go on.
Right.
Clearly, you are a product of that. Your mom is no longer here,
right.
But you are Fantasia. You are able to be the light of the light wherever you go.
Right.
So, you feel me? Like,
right.
So that's kind of what it was.
I almost cried, even. Sorry about that. Like, there's a twinkle in my eye. because it's one of the things all mothers, all women, are very symbolic and. We hold so much trauma for each other.
Yeah.
You know, that's that slogan of empower women,
yeah.
Right? Sometimes one woman goes through something just to reach back and give it back, and that's what she should do
yeah.
so that, you know, cycles don't continue to repeat.
Right.
And so you're changing the narrative on not just in your career, sisterhood, and in business relationships, but in parenting, authenticity.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, like, how do you feel about that authentic, like, has it always been like that? Or, like, it changed in some sort of way where it was, like, complete freedom to just be? Because that's your first person you were able to just be with.
Yeah. I feel like when it comes to, like you said, breaking the cycle, it started off small to me. Like, I was the first to graduate college. Cal State Fullerton with communications bachelor's of communications, emphasis in public relations. And I was the first generation. And so now my sister is in a position where she just got accepted to Jackson State. It seems small, but it's just like, you know, you right. It's like you paved the way.
Again, at the beginning of this, you know, we're both asking for space where we can just be transparent.
Thank you.
Where we can just be transparent and open and vulnerable enough, and we're trusting that this is a safe space. So, you know, you are the safe space, and making changes that impact legacy. A couple of weeks ago, we had a conversation about legacy, and you know, from my studies, one of the things I've come to realize is that legacy is not about, you know, the vast in front of you of what you created, but it's the length of the shadow that's behind you
right.
and what you created. And so what that means is that that power that you've been harnessing, and now you are exploding in this atomic, bountiful way, that legacy that you've already created is now passing down like a baton. That
right.
shadow is not just going to affect your family.
Right.
That shadow is going to be widened to affect multiple families.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? And that's a lot of responsibility.
Yeah.
I think that earlier when you said that, now I feel like I have to be her. It's
right.
almost like we put our foot in our mouth and we, you know, we say,
for sure.
Look, I know who I am. I'm a boss. I'm a this. And then we have to really live up to it.
Is yes. it? Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
No, it's that, oh, yeah?
Watch this.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, watch it.
Right. And I just was talking about this on my Instagram a couple of nights ago. I just felt, like, tight.
Yeah.
Like, I felt tight. I felt like I was out of control.
Mm-hmm.
been in the Bible, because I'm like, I need to go back to the Word. Yeah. What is the Word saying? Because clearly, I don't have no way out, and in addition to that, I don't have like a mother to reach out to give me that guidance.
But remember, we just having a conversation the other day. We was like, okay, I'm like, yo, what do we do when we wait?
It's in the waiting time, and you know, while you're in transition and everything around you is changing due to your impact, there's a waiting game that you must play. But it's what you do in that wait time. And that's what you do in that wait time. And, you know, again, just like looking at the energy that you've been able to accumulate, you just seem bigger than life right now. Bigger than life. When we had did the call with Nina, and boy oh boy, was this amazing. Yeah. If anybody didn't tap into that live, that live really brought some insight, girl.
And it was improv too.
It was so random.
I just got off the live with Old School Skinny. Shout out to them.
Okay.
I called up and then I said, yo, you wanna get a line? She's like, yeah. We on live, Nina tapping out, texting it, hey. And that's just confirmation of kind of what we're talking about, positions.
I'm a vortex.
I'm a producer.
Right.
And so I'm going to produce
some
stuff.
Right.
And so it just comes natural to us. And, But that's when we go to, like, moving in purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but the more I lean into that, I feel creative. I feel more in purpose.
Mm-hmm.
That's the promise of purpose that I need to lean into. And it all makes sense. Like, sometimes you kind of, like, don't know. You're in a, like, state of confusion or just kind of, like, in that waiting room. In that waiting room.
That weight is brutal, okay? Because if you are fighting towards something, or you are trying to create something and you feel like it's not being received,
right?
And you're putting your heart, blood, sweat, understanding, you putting everything that you have to give into this creation, and you feel it's not being received. That can hurt you while you're in the process of manifesting a manifestation.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But that's why you still, you believe the promise, and you still just do things to be active. Like, me and my dude, we watch YouTube videos, and, you know, we just gonna see.
Right.
Like, we just gonna exude and observe the information.
You gotta go there.
So when God say go,
right,
we ready.
Right.
All
right. Right. Because if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready.
Hello.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen to that.
Hello.
Okay.
Hello.
The entire vortex of everything.
And this was braiding hair, taking clients, making profit at 13 years old, where y'all step into. And this is 2 years in, but 13.
No. 14. This is 2020 when the whole world said stop.
That's when, right.
Let's
right.
be very clear.
Right.
You did something.
I'm rebellious.
Where the whole world
stop,
right? You know what I'm saying? I remember, I'm going to get a little intimate. I remember a call in 2020, and she was like, sis, I got it, but I'm about to create something.
Hello.
I'm rebellious. Yes. And she was like, I got these products. I'm gonna package it. I'm gonna give something. This I watch you. This young lady had nothing to give, and still you talk
oils.
About.
Yep.
Had nothing to give, and she still found something to give because you understand the cycle of reaping and sowing.
Yes.
Y'all know that you do not get anything if you do not sow a seed.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So that first seed of I'm going to sow this, even when I don't have it, and I'm going to put out campaigns, I'm going to start braiding hair, I'm going to do everything they're telling me I can't do,
right,
in like less than 6 months.
How about the product you're talking about is the Mega Moisturizer, which my home, shout out to Tracy, TC, she came up with the name. I had the oils, and I'm going to come back out with them. Hello. Okay, so.
Can I get a ring?
So the product, basically, you know the roll-on oils that you put on your skin, but it's for your scalp. So it's a great way to apply the oils on your scalp to where you feel
so great.
You roll it on to where you're massaging your scalp and you're getting the essential oils.
Mm-hmm.
So, game changer. And I was inspired by someone who did it, but I made it better.
Right.
And for my niche, my audience. And so it did so great. And this was during the pandemic before the shop. But with that, I gave away a scholarship,
right,
of $300, and my mom input her portion, and we gave it away to Tony Renee, who has Rejuvenate products, body oils and shea butters, body scrubs and stuff. Shout out to her. But even with that, I needed it, but I still gave. I gave away packages to 3 braiders of hair products, gel, all that. I dropped it off. Like, I was really pouring in.
So what you guys are witnessing, and even through the book, right? This is, again, I go back to that. I'm not new to this. I'm true to this, right? And you've been sowing seeds. They have to reap. You are in your new growth.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Giving when you have nothing to give. There was something that I used to do a while back when I was feeling low and empty, and you know, I was trying to manifest money in lump sums, and I think I told you about this. I used to go and put quarters in a meter.
Oh, yeah.
And by the time I'm done, I was like, look, I know I didn't piss the city off, but I know that with the money I've saved, I've already accumulated well over thousands of dollars. And so it felt like that was my physical money going out into the ether. And so, you know, you're in your new growth. I've been super excited to be in this first part of this because we're about to get to the nitty-gritty of things. But we're going to take an intermission, give everybody a little break, all right? And then ask